Good afternoon, good evening, fellow Toastmasters and guests, and my fellow speaker, Toastmaster Dinesh in particular. So he's going to deliver his project from the pathways, persuasive influence, and his project is titled Moderate a Panel Discussion. And the purpose of this project is for him to apply his skills as a public speaker and as a leader to facilitate the panel discussion. All the best, Toastmaster Michael Dinesh.
Toastmaster Michael, fit is not a destination, it is the way of life. Fit is not a destination, it is the way of life. Toastmaster Michael, over to you.
Thanks, Team Audi. Before I start the panel discussion, I just want to take the mercy of timer for a few minutes. Just want to check the connections of panelists. Vishal, Vikash and Kritika, can you make sure unmute yourself and try to speak something? Just say hi. Want to make sure.
Hi.
Hi, Michael.
Hi, Michael. Hi, Michael. Vikash here.
Okay. Thanks. We are good to start now. Timer, you can start your time. Okay. Fitness is not a destination. It is a way of life. Dear fellow Toastmasters and my dear guest, very good evening. Body is the biggest asset for each and every individual. The one and only thing we are going to carry till end of our life, not just till end of our life, even till our burial or the cremation, it is just the body you are going to carry. So are we really giving importance to our body? That is a question which we always have in our mind. Fitness or health is the most ignored word in today's world. The reason behind this is very simple. We people are very busy in selflessly working for our earnings. The great writer Paulo Coelho in his book Like the Flowing River said, we lose our health for earning, and at later stage we lose our earning to recover the health. Are we going to do the same? We are going to lose our health for earning right now, and later we are going to spend all our earnings to get back the same health. No, I think that should not be the way of life. We have to introspect our lifestyle now, and we have to have a healthiest and fit lifestyle. So this is the motive behind this panel discussion. Today in our podium, we have three great panelists from three different dimensions of fitness. I feel an immense pleasure in introducing them. First, let me go ahead with the panelist one. Vishal, the physical trainer. Vishal is an ACE certified personal trainer. He's an expert in martial art and karate, and he was selected as Master of Tamil Nadu in the year 2019. Ladies and gentlemen, join me in welcoming our first panelist, Vishal, Mr. Tamil Nadu 2019.
Thank you, Michael.
The panelist too, Kritika, psychotherapist. Kritika is a psychological counselor and NLP practitioner. She is running an organization called Bounce Big Psychological Counseling Center that deals with personality development and depression issues. Kritika is also well known in our Toastmaster fraternity to have served in Coromandel Toastmasters and speak to lead Toastmasters. Kritika, we welcome you for this panel discussion. Thanks for joining us. Let's put a big round of applause for Kritika.
Thank you, Michael.
Last but not the least, panelist three, Vikash, yoga guru. Vikash is a third generation yoga trainer in his family. His love for yoga started at the age of three. He had been consistently learning yoga techniques for the past 20 plus years, and he is running an organization called Yoga Fight from 2018. And he's also serving the spiritual needs of yoga trainees today. Vikash, welcome. We are great to have you for this panel discussion.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for having me here.
Ladies and gentlemen, with no further delay, I would like to kickstart my panel discussion. My first question would be to Vishal, the fitness trainer. Vishal, so here is my first question for you. Many of us, including me, assume like a well-built guy or a bodybuilder like you as fit. Is that really true? How do you define fitness? Can you please elaborate it, sir?
Okay, first of all, good evening to all the panelists out here and all the people out there listening to me out here. It's an honor to be here. First thing you said, a bodybuilder like me. Okay. The thing is, everyone, every individual is different on its own, on their own kind. And they cannot be a person who's similar to another. the way I define fitness is, it's not about just about, you know, building muscles. You can't, you know, pinpoint a person who has a lot of muscles, who has big muscles, a bulky physique, and tell him that he's fit, because muscles also contribute to a lot of body weight. Your heart is an organ which doesn't know the difference between carrying fat and carrying muscle. If you are overweight, it doesn't mind if you have a lot of fat in your body, or if you have a lot of muscle in your body, the consequences are going to be the same. So the thing about fitness, which I consider true fitness, is just say if someone has a lot of muscles, but he can't climb a flight of stairs or run a mile without, you know, being breathing heavily. That's not what I consider fitness. Fitness is something that I consider being better than someone who hasn't been into the fitness industry. So, you know, if you're better than a regular guy, if you're able to run faster than him, jump higher than him, and if you're able to, you know, endure more, that's what I consider real fitness. And yeah, so having muscles is just, you know, something flashy to look on the outside. Real fitness comes in your performance. It has nothing to do with muscles.
Thank you. That's a great answer, Vishal. So now at least people will come out of that misconception, like not the bodybuilders alone are fit. Even people who are slim can also be fit. Thanks for such a life-throwing answer, Vishal. Next, I would like to post my second question to Kritika, the psychotherapist. Kritika, here is a question for you. So many of us today are not aware of what is psychotherapy is. So many people who does not really want this counseling and psychotherapy are waiting in the doors of psychologists. And many people who are very badly in need of counseling are not getting an option of psychotherapy. So how do you look at that? When and why should we consult a psychotherapist? That's my question to you.
Thank you, Michael, for the question. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay. The thing is, we have to know who are all the professions in our field, okay? So who is a psychotherapist, who is a psychiatrist, and who is a psychologist? We have to know the difference first. So psychiatrist is the one who is a MBBS doctor. After finishing his MBBS, he is the one who has finished his 5 years, and he is a psychiatrist. He is eligible to prescribe medicines to those who are mentally ill. Okay, and there are some counselors. So they just provide emotional support. They give you support when there is a need. So there are counselors, and we are psychotherapists. So we are psychotherapists, we just don't give any support. We help the person to think on themselves. We enable them to take their own decisions. We'll be there with them when they are in the tough time, and we'll be helping them to take their own decisions. So there are many people in this profession, and they have their own specialization. And most of the time, people hesitate to meet a psychiatrist. People proudly say that I have a heart problem, but they hesitate to say that I have depression, I have anxiety, or any other mental problem. It's because of the stigma this society has created. If someone suggests a person to consult a psychologist or a psychotherapist, that person is offended. If someone asks the same person to meet a cardiologist or meet a gynecologist, the person is not affected. The person is not offended. But when someone suggests them to meet a counselor, the person is offended. So it's because of the stigma that the society has created. So we have to change that. So we have to create so much awareness. Okay. So everyone, first of all, I would like to tell you the difference between psychosis and neurosis. So there is some difference between common cold and cancer, right? So like that, there is a difference between neurosis and psychosis. Psychosis or serious mental illness. And neurosis is like headache that anyone can get it at any point of time. So people with neurosis, that is like a normal depression and anxiety, can meet a counselor. And people with some problem in their life at some situation can meet a counselor at any point of time. For that, we have to introspect and understand ourselves and understand our own problems.
Thanks, Kritika. That answers our question. So that was a clear explanation. Thanks for that. So moving on to my third panelist, I have this question to Vikash. So yes. Vikash, I yes. have been recently looking for alliances. Okay, I have uploaded all my pictures in matrimony sites, okay. and you know very well that I am a 92 born kid and I am 27 years old. People okay. are not ready to accept that I am 27. They say like okay. you are looking old. So this is a common fact in all the youngsters today. Does yoga have any anti-aging benefits? Doing yoga can keep us young. I'll be very happy if you can provide some answers on this.
Okay. First of all the best for you for your matrimonial site. Yes. About the anti-aging, how yoga can help you in anti-aging. So there has been recent studies going in abroad, especially in America, that somewhere in Chicago, in Northwest University, that they have chosen 12 of yoga practitioners, and they have gone through some studies, and they have proved that their papers are available over the net, and they have proved that there is anti-aging is also involved with your cellular age. You know, your each cell in your body also involves in your anti-aging process. So how yoga helps you here is, in yoga we follow 5 basic principles. The first principle is proper exercise. Proper exercise, each individual, as Vishal said, each individuals are different. So for each individual, the exercise may differ according to their capacity and possibilities. And second one is proper diet. Proper diet is, as you age, you have restrictions to food. So you have to manage your diet. And the next one is proper breathing. Breathing plays a major part in yoga. So apart from other exercise, the breathing in yoga, we have a separate yogic system for breathing. And those breathing techniques we apply in yoga while doing some of the asanas. Asanas are the postures. Next one, what we have is proper relaxation. Proper relaxation is nothing but when you do any task, you are physically tired and also mentally tired. So as you age, the mental tiredness takes toll on you. So for them, we teach proper relaxation techniques we call as yoga nidra. Yoga nidra means a blissfulness of sleeping. Sleeping as in not you sleep for 8 hours and then you wake up and you are still tired. Not in that way. We have certain techniques for yoga nidra. And then last but not least is positive thinking that we attain through meditation. Meditation is nothing but people have the misconception of meditation just to sit in closed eyes and, you know, sit in as in some postures and closed eyes and they keep thinking about certain things and chant some mantras. It's not about that. We have meditation techniques and we teach students on how to be meditative on each task they take. So this is how the anti-aging process works in yoga. And anti-aging is going to happen anyway. So you cannot run away from aging. Aging is going to happen for anyone for that matter. We have 2 types of aging happening to each individual. One is genetic and one is lifestyle. So how it depends on your lifestyle, the way you walk, the way you speak, the way you manage your food, as I said, and the way you compose your emotions, thoughts, and all those things plays a major factor on your aging. Genetic parts we can keep aside. That has to be addressed in a medicine, through medicine. But that numbers are very less. The lifestyle aging is more popular now. So more popular and it is more common to young people. So they are 27, they look like 40. And someone who are 40, they look like 60s. And in this lifestyle aging, we can address through yoga, through, as I told you, with these 5 basic principles. And I also wanted to mention this. Aging, people think aging is something that should not happen for them. And you cannot run away from that. It's a cycle, nature's cycle. All yoga can help you is age gracefully.
Yes. Got it. Thanks, Vikash Guruji. It was really a great answer. I think I'm inspired. I'm inspired by your answer. I would definitely join one of the yoga class to produce some anti-aging effects on me. So next question, I'm moving on to Vishal again. So Vishal, maybe before a year, I had a problem actually. Thing is my body mass index was perfect. I mean to say my weight and height ratio was very perfect, but I had a very big belly. People wanted to burn that people around me kept on saying, like, you burn your belly, you are looking so old. So I made sure I joined a gym. I was working out for 2 hours a day. But I felt like my belly was not going at all. I was doing all cardiac abs exercises and everything. But nothing, I don't know why it did not go. Few days later, I understood every day after my gym, there was a pizza hut near my gym. I used to go there and eat 2 cheese pizzas. So is that diet has something to do with this promising results, which is produced by the workouts? Does workout without proper diet can give a promising result?
Okay, the first thing you said, your BMI was right and you still had a big belly, right? BMI, yes, is something which is calculated medically. Say if you're, it is to put you in the range where you're underweight, you're normal, you're overweight, you're obese, and there's obesity grade 1, 2, that type of stuff. That is to assess if you're, how much risk you are at heart disease. That has nothing to do with the fitness. You could be in the normal weight category, have a proper BMI and still have a big belly. The thing about fitness is, it's about the way you look and the way you perform. Both are very different things. And you said diet has some impact. Diet doesn't have some impact. Diet is everything when it comes to fitness. You can work out all you want. You can work out like 3-4 hours a day. And if you still don't eat right, if you overeat or if you don't eat at all, or if you eat something without proper following a proper diet or following a certain meal plan, all you do is going to be wasted. Because the main misconception people have is, when they think of dieting, they think they shouldn't eat much. That is very wrong. You should eat what your body needs. When you're working out, you burn a lot of calories. In order to work out properly, you need to eat something. You need some calories in your body. Calories are nothing but energy. So when you get the right calories from proper sources, like there are 3 main macronutrients: proteins, carbohydrates, and fat. The way your body functions, you should assess your BMI first. You should assess the way you perform, what exercises you do. And you should create a diet which is specifically based for you. Because you can't just see someone who's following a diet plan. He might be older than you. He might be weighing difference. His body composition might be different than you. And what he's following might work for him. But you are a completely different individual. So you should find your own diet which works for you. And there are some people that I have seen, without working out, if they change their diet, if they regulate their eating pattern, if they eat like 4 meals a day, like at proper intervals, say if you wake up at 9, you eat your first meal, you eat a second meal at 12, third meal at 3 p.m. and your fourth meal at 6 p.m. and have a late night snack around 8 or 9 p.m. That is a proper regular diet. You need to follow it on a consistent basis to get adequate results. There are even people who don't even work out, who just do like cardio, as you said, like 30 minutes a day. And if they change their diet, they'll be getting immense results. You can say, once you change your diet, your body will start changing on its own. It's more of a healthy way of living. And you said you have been doing cardio and abs to burn your belly, right? That is totally wrong. The thing about burning your belly or your overall body fat is, you can't just target one specific part of your body and burn fat. It doesn't work that way. Everyone is different, as I told you. Some people store more fat on their arms. Some people store more fat on their belly. It's just genetically different. So you need to start working out. You have to start lifting weights, which burn more calories. The thing about cardio and ab training is, you burn calories only while you're doing a certain activity. But the difference is, when you start doing weight training, your tissues in the muscles start to tear down. So the rebuilding process requires a lot of protein. So when protein molecules are ingested in your body and the repair takes place, muscular repair takes place, that in turn burns a lot of calories. So just remember, when you're doing cardio, you burn calories only while doing the cardio. When you're doing weightlifting, even at rest, you are burning calories. That is the difference between cardio and weight training. So I suggest anyone who's trying to get fit, do weight training, do resistance training, and do cardio along with that. But the main thing is, you need to have proper sleep and proper diet. Without proper sleep and proper diet, no matter how hard you work out, it's not going to happen. It's just the way it is. It's more of a lifestyle than, you know, working hard. It's actually a lifestyle you have to follow.
Thanks, Vishal. That answers my question. So the lifestyle change is something that you have to change yourself to see a change in your body. That was a promising answer, and it was really convincing too. Again, I'm moving on to Kritika for other question. Kritika, I come from an IT background. I see 2 type of people with me. Okay, there are few are like wall clock. They never sleep. At any point of time, I can call them and speak. and few, they sleep continuously for 12 hours, 13 hours. I'm strange. I feel strange. So is this something called sleep insomnia? Yeah. Do we have any techniques in psychotherapy to deal with insomnia, oversleeping, or sleeplessness? Can you elaborate on that?
Yes. First of all, I just want to clarify one thing. Insomnia is not just because of psychological reasons. There are many biological reasons behind insomnia. So once you think that you have insomnia or hypersomnia, you have to consult a doctor and rule out the biological causes. So sometimes when the problem is with the body and we are treating the mind, so it will end up in a wrong way. So first of all, you have to rule out the biological causes. So when once it you conclude that this insomnia is because of depression or insomnia is because of some psychological reason, there is a difference in, there are many different types of insomnia. Okay. Sometimes we go to bed by 9 o'clock, but still 12 o'clock or 1 o'clock or 2 o'clock, it could not catch the sleep, right? And by the time of 2 o'clock, we sleep. And in the morning, we can sleep till 10 like that. So even we have 8 hours of sleep, but it is very difficult for us to catch sleep. So it is, there is a difficulty in falling asleep. And another type of insomnia is we sleep by 9 o'clock and we wake up in between by 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock, and it is difficult for us to catch the sleep back again. So we just wake up, we remain wake up. So that is, that's the another thing. And there is one more thing, that is we cannot sleep throughout the night. Some people, at times we cannot sleep at night and we compensate that the very next day, right? The next day we sleep extra time. So when it's not happening, when you are not sleeping throughout the day, 1 day, 2 days and 3 days, so it's a very difficult thing. So in such a case, you have to meet a psychiatrist. Okay. So you cannot waste the time with a counselor. So when you have difficulty in falling asleep because after an event, like after a love failure, after losing a job, like reactive depression, that is the thing, that is the insomnia that is caused by reactive depression. So in such a case, when we treat the depression, we can treat that insomnia. Okay. We can help you to reframe your thoughts. We can help you to follow regular practices like going for a walk every day, avoiding coffee before you go into sleep. And we have some breathing exercises. When you practice that, you can fall asleep, and you have to treat your mind also. We have to counsel you also in parallel. So insomnia, we cannot conclude that it's just because of psychological reasons. It can be because of biological reasons like hormone imbalance. Even TB patients find difficult to fall asleep. So you have to take care of all these things.
Thanks, Kritika. That's really a great answer. So you have clearly explained what are the causes that is behind sleeplessness and everything, and how you can treat it about. So that's really a good answer, Kritika. Thanks for it. Moving on to the third panelist, Vikash again. So Vikash, so ever since COVID has started, so in Tamil Nadu, I'm hearing one word frequently. That is something called comorbidity. So comorbidity is a condition like some other medical complication along with COVID. So which points to hypertension, diabetes, and asthmatic allergies. Does yoga provide any ways to develop immunity against these comorbidities? Can you explain on that?
Yes, I can explain you on that. And it's a very interesting question. It's a need of the hour now. What happens in yoga, we have two types of exercise to address in yoga. As I explained before, apart from the five basic principles, we have exercise which is macro in size. So we do many exercise, macro in the size, like raising your hand up and putting your hands down, and all those exercises are macro exercise. We also have a micro exercise, which in a way activates each and every point in your body. For the immune system in yoga, we have certain points called as marmas. Marmas are the points are very specific. So these points which activates the lymphatic system in our body. In a way, lymph works as a factor for the immune to boost up the immune system. So in a way, we activate the lymph system through the micro exercises. Micro exercises are nothing but touching that particular point to in a way to activate those sensitive points. this is one aspect of improving the immunity through yoga. And other part is through breathing exercise and meditation. So there was a new article in a couple of weeks back. I saw a new article. I was very surprised, and I was not surprised. I was really surprised. They actually took an initiative to publish those articles that there is some breathing technique called Kapalabhati. Kapalabhati is rapid breathing technique, and that helped a COVID positive patient to recover. Kapalabhati breathing technique. I'm not telling you just do Kapalabhati to come out of certain ailments. It's not like that. We have yogic breathing techniques which will activate certain hormones in your system. If there is any repair in certain hormones, these breathing techniques will really go there and fight those viruses or fight those ailments, and then you recover out of it. And also our body, basically our body has a self-healing mechanism. You get wounded, your body sends a signal and it covers it up. So your body has that self mechanism and self fighting capabilities. In yoga, we just try to activate that self healing mechanism. We do it through meditation, we do it through breathing techniques, and we do it through asanas. Those are physical exercises. And coming to ailments, some are chronic and some are lifestyle. So chronic has to be addressed in different aspect in yoga, because now the term yoga has been so much mixed up. So I wanted to make it clear that some yoga, the lifestyle disease can be cured or prevented through certain type of yoga, which is called Hatha yoga. And some of the chronic ailments can be cured only through Kriya yoga. Kriya yoga is nothing but cleansing your system. So there are two different types of yoga. For example, if you say you have asthma and you just go do Hatha yoga, that's not going to help you. Hatha yoga is nothing but a physical exercise you do to your body. And it's not going to help you. It is not going to serve the purpose. For that, you have to do Kriya Yoga, which involves breathing and certain procedures to attain to that asthma. So there are different types of yoga. Now we are only looking at the physical yoga. Most of the youngsters are only aware of the physical yoga. But there are more other types of yoga which will help you in the chronic ailments also.
So thanks, Vikash. That was really a beautiful answer. So people who have asthmatic or hypertension, they want to reduce, definitely they should think of yoga. That should be a right option. With this, I am done with all my questions. Now it's time for us to open up to QA from audience. So audience, whoever like to raise a question, please unmute yourself, and you can point questions through any of the panelists through me. So if you want to post any question, please unmute yourself and raise your hand.
Yes, Coach, Toastmaster Michael, I have a question. Yes,
whom do you want to have a question?
Yeah, yoga practitioner Mr. Vikas also.
Okay.
Yeah, regarding the diet or relevant to dieting system, how fasting can able to balance our system, and how during fasting we can able to practice yoga steps?
Okay, that's an interesting question. Yes. So fasting plays a major role in our entire body. So for example, you can take automobile. You keep running the automobile, fueling up and running the automobile. Even the automobile needs certain rest. The silencer gets heats up, the engine gets heated up. So even the automobile needs rest. Same mechanism is this. We apply for our human system. We keep running, we consume food and we use that food energy in our workspace and in our thoughts and emotions. So fasting plays a major role in addressing and repairing certain systems in our body. But also extended fasting is not advisable for people who have certain health issues. The extended fasting, they should avoid extended fasting. There are many people who think just they don't eat food, they starve themselves and they can overcome obese. That's not how your system works. You should eat in right time, right food, and you should have proper intervals. And you should have a balanced diet. More than fasting, you should have a balanced diet. For example, if you're going to eat only proteins for a day, then you have to look for some carbohydrates. and little good fat. Something like this is called as balanced diet. And to be very precise, extended fasting will damage your system. It's not going to help you in reducing your weight. Yes.
Thanks, Vikash, for such a beautiful answer. So now I have Antonio Akash with a question. And Akash, whom do you want to pose your question to?
I want to ask to Vishal, the bodybuilder.
Okay, so young blood towards bodybuilding. Okay, go ahead and shoot.
Yeah, so like 3 years back, I took personal training and got 6 packs, and for which I had to spend a lot. So that time I understood for being healthy, you need to actually spend a lot more than, you know, actually being fat. So like, what do you say for that? How to like have a healthy lifestyle, you know, in economical way, because, you know, having a 6 pack, you need to like, I needed to take some 750 gram of chicken, 20 eggs per day. And the budget goes somewhere around, including post trading, it went around 20,000 per month. So if I want to like have without.
You want to do it with the budget, is it? Okay. Do you go partying and all? Do you go to movies, you go to party, you go to vacations and all, right? How much do you spend over there usually?
Not gone much, but if I go there, it takes around somewhere around 10, but to go okay. 10 to 20.
Okay, you spend so much for 10 to 20 for a temporary happiness or something. Okay. The thing is, bodybuilding or building a good physique is all about preference. Okay. Say if you go to a hotel and you spend a lot of money for eating junk food for one particular meal, say if you're going for a family dinner or something, that is going to cost a buck, okay? And the same thing, you buy chicken, you buy eggs, you buy vegetables. Yeah, that is a quite a healthy investment compared to what you're eating outside, compared to junk. So it's all, it comes down to your own preference. And regarding personal training, the way I train people is, I teach my clients how to, you know, to realize the body, to know what they can block and to discover themselves. That is quite different than blindly trusting your trainer and just asking him what to do and following the same without learning anything. The thing I suggest you is learn what works for you. Learn how your body responds. Because before the trainer, you are the one who gets to know how your body responds, what your body is going through. You only give him the feedback of what your body is going through. So just learn to exercise by yourself. Learn what works for you. Do your own thing. And doing it on a budget is just a healthy investment. Of course, vegetables, chicken, eggs, everything is going to cost a buck. But it all comes down to your own personal preference. If you want to be fit, don't live a healthy life, it is a big investment. Mm-hmm. To trim it down, you need to, you know, find a way to fit it inside your regular meals. You don't have to diet all the way long. And the thing about six-pack is, you know, most people think that people who have six-pack are really healthy. The thing I tell you is, no, they're not. If you're below 10% body fat, you are unhealthy. You will be having hypertension, you will be having anxiety, and you will be, you know, starving yourself, and you'll be deprived so much. The hormone balance will not be regulated. So if you're keeping your body fat from 10 to 15%, which is sustainable through regular diet and training, you're healthy. It does cost a buck, but it's worth the investment the way I see it. Thank you.
Thanks, Vishal. That was really a great answer. And for one thing, I just wanted to tell people, Akash asked about a question about expenses involved. People are not just ready to spend money for fitness, and they are also not ready to spend time for fitness. They are able to spend time for many things, but they are not able to do it for fitness. If we are not going to spend money for fitness, again, we may be forced to spend money in hospitals.
Exactly.
So we have to think about it. So now I already got a question for Kritika from Toastmaster Srihari. So Srihari, can you go ahead and shoot your question to Kritika?
Yeah, my question is about when we work in IT environment, especially, right? What happens is that sometimes personally, I get into some sort of depression mode, especially when my superiors, they prove me wrong, especially in my self-worth. They prove, you know, he's not worth to do or to take up this bigger task. Sometimes it happens. I work really hard. At that point of time, I know that I can do that, but the superiors around me, like they say, you know, you can take it next time, something like that. In order to overcome that sort of depression at that moment, so are there any instant techniques to come over that and then like concentrate on the next task?
Yes, I can understand your question. But the only thing is you use the word depression. Actually, we colloquially use the word depression whenever we are upset, right? So depression is a mental illness. I just want to clear that out. There are some symptoms that if it is corona, it should have the following symptoms, right? So like that, depression has some symptoms. That is feeling worthless, helpless. So we lose our interest in all the activities we had interest before. We lose our sleep, sometimes sleeplessness or excessive sleeping. And we don't eat at all or we eat a lot. So these are the symptoms of depression, okay? So feel guilty all the time. We have pervasive sadness for more than 2 weeks. So these are the symptoms of depression. But we colloquially use the term depression for any kind of emotional upset. So for answering that question you asked, sometimes people pull us down. They make us believe that we cannot excel in our life. So how can we handle that immediately? So that's my question, right? So when we are emotionally upset, not just because someone is pulling us down, it can be on any other reason, okay? So if you want to switch our mood immediately in a fraction of seconds, so we can do one thing. So there is a breathing technique which we can use at any stages of our life, during any event easily, and it helps you to shift your mood from down to up. So that is, you have to inhale through your nostrils, you have to hold the breath as long as you can, and you can slowly exhale through your mouth. So if you repeat it for 5 to 10 times, you can feel the shift in your emotions. Okay, that you can do. And sometimes when people are pulling us down and you don't want to get influenced by that, you can imagine them like having big ears, having a long nose, having a bulged out eyes. Like that is, the technique is called cartoon technique. When you imagine them as a cartoon and repeat the same experience, that emotion, you will be dissociated from that emotion. You remember what happened, but you are not emotionally carried away by that event. So this technique is called cartoon technique. You can visualize them as a cartoon, having a long ears and long nose, a large mouth, like that. Okay? And just visualize that experience again, and you can dissociate from that emotion and you can carry on your work.
Thank you so much, Akhilika. Thank you.
Thanks, Kritika. That was really one more, again, provoking answer. So I have so many people ping me for questions. So with interest of time, I just have to give one person who pinged me last. For others, I would recommend you to contact the panels in WhatsApp or in Facebook, and they are always available to take questions. Panelists, please give me that privilege. Our members are interested to connect with you after the session. Please allow me and give me that opportunity. So one last question from Anand Raj.
Good evening. My question to psychotherapist Kritika. How to keep stay us in positive momentum in always? Whatever may be the situation, we should be in positive moment.
Okay. The first thing is we should not have that thought. I just want to be positive all the time. It's not practical. Okay? So we have to accept the emotional ups and downs. Once we accept it, sometimes we deny. No, I'm not feeling bad. I'm not feeling upset. So that denial can end up in a big problem. So we should not deny that. So every day cannot be the same. So sometimes we feel low. It's okay. We have to accept it. And then we have to try to overcome that. Okay? So for that, we can... What are some events that caused in our life is the reason for our emotional downs, right? So at that time, we have to try to reframe it. Okay? Say, example... can you give me an example that for an event that caused you some emotional turbulence in your life? A simple example, a day-to-day example.
We will think that if there is a pain in our body, so we will feel that this may be the disease, or that may be the disease, something like that. Most of the people, they go to the Google and they find out the symptoms. So in that case, how to come out from that? This may be the example.
Yeah, this one we call it as maximization. Okay, there is a small pain in our body, but we are maximizing it. We are blowing it up and making a mountain out of a mole, right? So that kind of thing. So we have to question ourselves whether it is rational. So when we start questioning our thought, most of our beliefs are irrational. Most of our beliefs that causes pain are irrational. So once we question our own belief, we can analyze, we can understand that, okay, it's a rational thought I had, so I don't have to. So you have to, the thing is, you have to treat yourself like a child. That is an inner child. You have to treat yourself like a child. You have to question your child and you have to console your child. So unless you nurture your child, you cannot be happy all the time. So you have to treat, there is a child inside, the child is afraid of it. So all is well, that is told by Vijay in a French movie, right? So that is the technique. So you have to treat yourself like a child and you have to answer your child, you have to nurture your child, you have to console your child. So that can keep you positive.
Okay. Thank you, Kritika, psychotherapist. Thank you again.
Thanks, Anand and Kritika, for such a beautiful question and answer. So ladies and gentlemen, with this, we are coming to an end of this panel discussion. I take great pleasure again thanking all three panelists, Vishal, Kritika and Vikash, for having their giving their time slots for our club and making an effort to answer all our questions. Thanks. Let's give them a big round of applause. They deserve much more than that. So to all the audience who is watching, just want to say, I'm not an expert like these three persons. I just want to say one thing. So health and fitness is not an option. We have to keep it in mind. We don't need a fever to tell that our body is not okay. We don't need a headache or migraine to tell that we have a head. We have to be cautious about it. It is the biggest hazard. How fit you are, how best you deliver. That's what I believe. So when you're strong enough, you can break any challenges. Maybe it is physically, mentally, or spiritually, we can rock the challenges. So fitness is not a destination, it's a way of life. Let's leave with that motto. With this, I'm concluding this panel discussion and handing over the stage back to Toastmaster of the day, Srihari. Thank you.
Thanks, Michael, and thanks for all the panelists. So that was a wonderful panel discussion. Okay.